Let's go ahead and tidy up a couple of loose ends. What's up? I'm Jonathan, and welcome to Maker Tales, where I'm sharing my maker journey to help you go further in yours. So don't forget to subscribe and hit that little bell icon to never miss an opportunity to keep making. This video is all about showing you a couple of loose ends that I find very useful within my Blender precision workflow. I'm going to be keeping this video as short and to the point as possible, as they're not really that complicated. So first one is, I did show you the 3D edge loop before when we were creating this rod here, but I just want to show you it within a little bit more detail. So for instance, this entire face edge loop around this cube is a face edge loop. And so if I go ahead here and I hold down Alt and I click on this side, it's going to select that edge loop there. Now let me show you this in a little bit more detail by creating a cube here. And this is going to be the point where it's going to make the most sense. So if I move this up here, so if I wanted to select the edge loop all around this face here, I go Alt and click, and it does this edge loop here. However, if I wanted it to have been the other edge loop, I go as close to that edge as possible, and then I do my Alt click. And that's how you're able to do different selections of edge loops really quickly of around an object of faces. Do keep in mind that when there are seams like this though, the edge loop will be broken. So for instance, if I were to select here, you see that there is a seam line right here. So I'm gonna actually have to physically go shift select those, but then I can go ahead here again and go Alt shift and click, and then I can carry on doing my selection. So shift click these, and then the rest of this edge loop should be able to finish off by going Alt shift and click. I'm going along this direction, and this one, because there is a seam right here, I have to do it this way. But that there is how to do edge loop selection. Having shown you how to do a loop selection, let me actually show you how to do a loop cut as well. This one is very much within more of an organic modeling workflow, but it can be extremely useful. So I'm going to go to the cube here because it's not going to work so great on this object, and I'll explain why later. But what I'm showing you is this here, which is the loop cut, or the shortcut is Control R. And you'll see, because I already had an edge selected, it moves here. And then whichever edge I move to, it shows you this yellow line. Now you can use the scroll wheel to add more edge loops to this. I'm going to leave this with one. I'm going to left click. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to move it all the way to one edge, because this is usually how I use it. Then I do a click. I already have my CAD transforms turned on. So I'm going to go and do a G for moving. I'm going to move from this vertex, and I'm going to constrain it on the Y. And now we can move this to whatever distance I'm wanting. So let's go 0.25. Fantastic. Now, if I wanted to go ahead and cut this up again, well, you can use the knife tool, which is the one over here. But I usually prefer using the loop cut, because what I'm able to do is do the loop cut. I can then divide my surface up to what I'm wanting here. Then I can do a click, and then I can right click to bring it back to where it was snapped to the zero factor. And of course here I can increase the loop cuts manually later on. Let's say I actually wanted three. And then I can go ahead and do my face selection and select these here and extrude those up. Just like I showed you in one of the first videos showing Blender though, we're going to have all these leftover edge loops. So it's up to you how you want to use this loop cut. I usually leave those till I'm later on in my model, and then I go into my edge selection, and then I go ahead and just use my circle select, deselect what I'm not wanting, select all the things that I am wanting. I'm not going to select them all now, and then hit our X, and I dissolve all the edges that I don't need. Now the reason why the loop cut isn't going to work on our object down here is because the way that we have our edges set. So because we have this edge here, and it isn't actually creating an edge, so to speak, from one edge to another edge, it's creating almost a triangle shape here. the loop cut won't actually know how to do this loop cut. You will see that there will be sections that it knows where to do the loop cuts and how to do them, but that's the reason why. It's because this here, it's not a face-to-face to just one face to another face. Here, it's a weird shape that's going on. However, what it will work with is things such as this cube here. So we could do a loop cut right here, and that works perfectly fine. Use our scroll wheel to add more. This then lets us go and do something crazy like this. We can then go into our face selection, use our newly discovered loop selection, and select these faces here. Then we can go ahead and extrude these out. Oh, making sure that we are setting this extrusion correctly. Extrude via the normals, and there we go. We can do some crazy, crazy things here. But for instance, that's an example where the loop cut was actually very handy. Of course, if you're going to do this with precision, you would go about and make sure that those first loop cuts that were set here, that you actually had them already set to how you wanted them. So making sure that they were set at the distance that you wanted from such another edge. As you've seen, selection is very important within Blender, and there is one very powerful way of doing selection that I haven't shown you yet. And so I'm going to go and do this with the face selection. And what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to go out here and I'm going to create a weird shape. I'm going to create an icosphere here. And let's go into edit mode. Let's go and scale this up. It doesn't really matter where I'm scaling this. I'm going to scale this three-dimensionally. And now this selection method needs the numpad plus and minus. So I'm not 100% sure how you would do this on a laptop, but I'm pretty sure you using the emulate numpad, the plus and minus up on the top right will work just fine. And the way this works is by using control plus will increase your selection. And there you have it. Increasing and control minus is decreasing. Now, what's really powerful of this is that you can actually do this on two points and it will select from here. So I use this quite extensively sometimes in my models because it's a great way of selecting, for instance, all of one thing when you can't see it by just pressing it lots of times and then you have it there. It's as easy as that. So for instance, let's say we couldn't see the inside, the rest of this model here. Well, we could go into it. We could select just one face and then hit control and plus, and then we're selecting all the faces, press that a couple of times, and then we know that we've selected it all. And that there is the numpad selection increasing and decreasing. Also, keep in mind that this also works with edges and vertices. So for instance, if I went to this edge here, well, increasing just by one edge is going to select all the other edges. So it's a pretty decent way of selecting. So also showing you that in the vertex selection. So if I were to start here and carry on going plus, it's going to select all the vertices that are basically to relation to it. Something else that's quite useful is the ability of being able to hide objects. Now, I have shown you how to hide objects here in the hierarchy, but there's also a shortcut. So let's select an object and then you hit H. Now, if you want to bring that object back, well, bring back all objects, it is Alt H. Now, you can also isolate objects by going Shift H, and this isolates an object for you to be able to edit with. Or you can go Alt H and bring it back. Of course, you can just go ahead, select all the objects that you're not wanting and just hit H lots of times to hide that away. That can be extremely useful when you're trying to, for instance, I want to see this rod here. Well, I'm going to go here, make sure that I'm in selection, select this, I go H, and now I can see what I was wanting to work with. And then I can bring it all back with Alt H, and there it is. Now, you can also hide collections with Control H. So right this minute, it lets me hide collections. So this goes back to the organization video, where we're able to create collections, and here's another use case for it, because if we go here, and we say, actually, we're wanting to hide all of this, this would then leave us to the hide collection of the collection one, and for some reason, it's not hiding it. I think it might be because we don't have any other collections in place. Let's just add another collection, put that into collection two. Alt-H hide collection, side collection 2. So you've got to make sure you have two collections, and then we can go Alt-H and show collection 1, and that's a way of being able to basically organize your workflow very easily. Lastly, it's one more add-on. And this add-on is one that I probably should have shown earlier on, but well, we're here now. So let's go ahead and let's enable it. You go into Edit, Preferences, Add-ons, and what we're looking for here is TinyCAD Mesh Tools. So enable this one, it comes with Blender, and more than anything, it just adds some functionality to some very commonly used things. So let's go ahead and let's just go get our 3D cursor here. Let's create a single vertex. Let's extrude this vertex this way. And now let's go put this one here and extrude a single vertex once again this way here. And here's what's powerful of TinyCAD. It's one of the most powerful features I find is by selecting all of this and you right click it, and there you'll have it. TinyCAD is this V to X auto, and this does intersection points super quickly for you. It's probably one of the quickest ways of doing intersection points because you just select it all up and that's it. Now go ahead to the documentation down in the description, because there's a whole bunch more other simple things that this does beautifully that when it comes to it, it really is the fastest way of doing some of the operations. With these loose ends now wrapped up, you have a solid foundation of precision modeling in Blender. Next up, I'm going to show you how to put this into practice. I'm going to give you some challenges and some examples of some real practical use cases right away. And then we're going to talk about the future of what this series has for you. A huge thank you to my patrons. Honestly, it means the world to me. And if you've enjoyed this series and you think I'm worthy of your support, I would love to see you there too. Thanks for watching, keep making, and let the quest continue.